welcome back to this Ansys module on designing waveguides using the Ansys Electronic Desktop Student Version, AEDT student for short. And in that previous module, we discussed the need of why to use electromagnetic solvers like AEDT HFSS to give you a better understanding of the propagating modes in a waveguide. And in this video module, we're going to discuss how and why wave propagates in different modes inside a rectangular waveguide by discussing and detailing the governing equations. And we'll start the discussion with the geometry of the rectangular waveguide. As the name suggests, the cross-section of the waveguide cavity is a rectangular shape with one dimension always greater than the other. And a typical waveguide cavity is filled with some dielectric, with a permittivity of epsilon and a permeability of mu, and walls are made of some conducting material. The larger and the smaller dimensions are labeled as A and B, respectively, and they're aligned along the X and Y axis, respectively. And as the rectangular waveguide is made up of just a single conductor, the TEM mode doesn't exist. It's not possible. So only TE transverse electric and TM transverse magnetic propagations are possible. Let's derive these modes. Let's start with recalling Maxwell's equations for a source-free region in phasor format as shown. And the electric and the magnetic fields have components along the X, Y, and Z axis. So here it's designated as EX, EY, HX, and HY are the transverse components. And EZ and HZ are the longitudinal components to the wave propagation. And these fields are propagating along the Z axis, so the variation along the axis will be in terms of E to minus J beta Z, where beta is the propagation constant for that medium, that dielectric. And expanding these equations in terms of the individual components and expressing them as transverse components in terms of the longitudinal components gives you these equations. Now, K of C is the cutoff wave number and is defined as K is the wave number in the medium or the dielectric and is given by omega times the square root of mu times epsilon or 2 times pi divided by lambda. First, let's find a solution for the longitudinal components of the fields. And then we'll go on to the transverse components derived from the longitudinal components. Let's first consider a general function phi to represent the longitudinal component for deriving the general solution. For that TE case, transverse electric, the function is equal to H of Z as E of Z equals zero. And for the TM case, this function is equal to E of Z as H of Z equals zero. So we'll use the wave equations in terms of these functions, which are given by. And expanding the del operator yields, and if that electric field component is expressed as the product of the individual functions, x, y, and z, x of x, y of y, z of z, and using the separation of variable method, the partial differential equation, the PDE, can be written in terms of the normal differential equation as shown here. And divide the equation with x, y, and z gives this. The solution for this differential equation exists only if each of the terms is equal to some constant. So let's use the separation constant as k of x, k of y, and beta, and divide it as shown. And they're related to the wave number as shown here. And these three equations are also expressed as follows. And the general solution for these differential equations is given by where C1 to C6 are the integration constants. And notice that the solution for the Z direction is given by the sum of both the forward and the backward traveling wave, transmit and a reflection. And for a forward traveling wave, C6 is zero, and the other constants C1 to C4 can be determined by using boundary conditions. To use the boundary conditions, let's replace the general function for that TE and TM case. For the TE transverse electric case, the solution for the longitudinal magnetic field component H of Z is given as shown. And since the boundary conditions can be applied to the electric field, the transverse field along X for H of Z can be given by, and along the Y direction, the boundary conditions for the electric field tangential component where EX is zero at Y equals zero, Y equals a B. Applying these conditions for Y equals zero, EX can only be zero if C4 is equal to zero, and for Y equals B, and EXE can only be zero if KY equals N pi over B, where N is an integer and has values 0, 1, 2, and so forth. An integer. Similarly, the other transverse fields for H of Z can be given by this equation. And with the boundary conditions, E of Y equals 0 at X equals 0 and X equals A gives you C2 equals 0 and K of X equals N pi over A, and M has values 0, 1, 2, integer, and so on. And the final equation for the Z component of the magnetic field is shown here. C is the product of the integral constants C1 and C3, and it represents the amplitude of the field. For the transverse magnetic case, the TM case, the solution for the longitudinal electric field component E of Z is shown here. Applying the boundary conditions as we did to the TE modes, directly to this equation, we see that C1 and C3 are equal to zero, and Kx equals n pi over A, and Ky equals n pi over B, and which results in the equation here. And C is the product of the integral constants C2 and C4, and that represents the amplitude of the field. And the values of M and N define the mode of the fields, or the number of half cycles along the axis in the transverse plane. So the TE and TM modes are defined using M and N as indices and are represented here. The normal convention is to use mode numbers along the larger dimension first, followed by the mode number along the smaller dimension. So recalling that equation relating the propagation constant to the wave numbers along the X, Y, and the Z directions, we rewrite this equation to represent the propagation constant in terms of the wave number, gives you this. And substituting those values for Kx and Ky, which gives you this. And for a propagating wave, the value of propagation constant should also be real. And for propagating constant to be real, the values of k squared should always be greater than the sum of the squares of the wave numbers along the x and y axis. There exists a condition for the propagation to be zero. And if these terms are equal, for which the wave number is defined as the cutoff wave number, and it's given by this equation. And as the wave number depends on the frequency, this equation can be rewritten to define f of c, the cutoff frequency. And this purely depends on the number of m and n. That means the cutoff frequency is different for different modes. And from this equation, it's evident that the mode propagation exists only when the operating frequency is greater than the cutoff frequency. Hence, waveguides act as a high pass filter above some frequency. So let's find out what the minimum number of values for M and N are for the TE and TM modes by using their longitudinal wave components. For the first case, where M and N are equal to zero. For the TM case, EZ equals zero would mean there's no wave propagating. And for the TE case, H of Z will remain constant in the XY plane. So the transverse fields will be zero. Hence, M and M cannot be zero simultaneously for a rectangular waveguide. And case two, when one of M and or N is zero. And for the TM case, E of Z equals zero, which means for TM propagation, a mode does not exist if M or N is zero. For the TE case, the variations along that transverse plane occurs, and thus the propagation is possible. For TE10 and TE01 modes are possible, and particularly the cutoff frequency for the TE10 mode is lower than that of the TE01 mode. So the TE10 is the dominant mode in the rectangular mode, as this is the lowest possible mode whose cutoff frequency is given by here. And so case three, both M and NN are non-zero, and the propagation is possible for both TE and TM modes. They have some same cutoff frequencies for a given M and N. And these are the governing equations for the rectangular waveguide. In the next module, we're going to simulate that rectangular waveguide in the AEDT student version using the HFSS solver. Thank you for watching this module. And to find more information on AEDT, HFSS, or any of the ANSYS simulation tools, please go ahead and go to ANSYS.com/courses today.